Sandra here, and welcome to my channel, Stars and Palm, and here I am with another planner on a budget type video. I know that you guys really enjoyed my last one, and I wanted to create another one showing you other goodies that you can get that are also on a budget. All these items I picked up at Michael's, and they were a really great price. I believe I got everything for around $20, and if you use coupons and things, sometimes you can get some things even cheaper, but basically it was really cost efficient. Now, I do want to preface this by saying, yeah, there's a lot of other budget-friendly ways that you can buy things and get a planner that's maybe $10, but this is just one that I thought was fun because it's more customizable than, let's say, just buying a notebook that's a planner. But if you want to do that, that's great too. This is just a fun way to show you what you could do if you picked up this specific planner, because there's lots of fun ideas and things you can do with it, and they have so many different options at Michael's for the type of items that you can get. So I will show you guys probably at the end, or insert them here, of different things that they do have at Michael's. I just happened to pick up the calendar book and a few of the extra little goodies because I didn't need all of the extra stuff that they have, but just to give you guys an idea. So I hope you enjoy this, guys. So to start off with, you could either pick up one of these types of covers that they have, which are already pre-made, and they're pretty affordable. I believe it's like $7 for the cover, and if you use a coupon, it's even less than that, as you can see. And those are the different options that they have if you go to Michael's and you decide to go that route. Just keep in mind, they're kind of annoying to put on the actual cover. I realize that you have to put it on from the back to front, not the other way around. Just because if you don't do it that way, you're not going to be able to get it on, literally, like... it's a nice fit. For overall, it's a pretty good fit. It's not too loose and not too tight, but it's just kind of a pain to put on. I also picked up a canvas version of this cover because I thought it would be fun to show you how you could customize a canvas version if you did decide to pick one up to do this type of technique. Like, I could have left it plain or even sewn something onto the front or ironed something on. There's so many different options of what you can do, but I had this really cool feather stencil that I picked up recently, and if I can find it online, I will link it in the description box below. Anything I can find online, I will link in the description box. Whatever's not linked is probably not available online. But I just thought this would be a cool way to kind of just customize a cover. But like I said, there's plenty of other ways that you could have done this. This is just what I thought would be fun. So I picked up these acrylic paints that I had, and this little dauber tool, which is a sponge. And I'm just going to be using it to do a pouncing sort of motion where you go up and down and just kind of like just dabbing it without making sure that I'm moving the stencil, because if you move your stencil, then you're going to kind of mess up the design. Now, when you use a stencil, you're not going to get a perfect look, and you cannot do this with watercolors, in case you guys were wondering that. I'm using this acrylic paint because you need it to be kind of a thicker type of paint to do this, and you want to make sure that, like I said, you're not moving that stencil around, and you're making sure not to do a wiping motion, but just an up and down motion, because if you don't do it that way, the paint will get underneath the stencil, which can happen very easily with stencils. So you just want to make sure to be consistent with that, and you also want to make sure you don't use too much water or anything like that when doing this as well, because you want to keep that consistent sort of more of a dry texture to the paint, because that'll help you to get a more finished look to this, the whatever it is that you stencil. It'll make sense when you're doing this, and I would even recommend practicing on a piece of paper first if you're planning on doing this on canvas, just to make sure that you get a good look and a good imprint, because once you do it, there's really no going back, and you don't want to mess up a cover that you've paid money for if you don't think you're going to get a good look out of this. I've worked with stencils before, and I know that you generally can't get an absolutely perfect look from it, but if you kind of do it the way I'm doing it, you'll get a pretty nice look out of it. And for the blending of the colors, what I'm doing is I'm not wiping off the sponge, and I'm mixing it into the next color to create kind of that gradient effect. And then once I want more of the true color, I add more of that color and I kind of wipe off the sponge, which I do off camera on a piece of paper. And I just let the smallest amount of water just wipe off on the brush just to get that color and clean it off so that I get a more true color. So like that yellow right there, I made sure to wipe off any blue I had left on that sponge to make sure that I had a true yellow at the end of that feather instead of getting that green color. So now I have all of those done, which I did off camera just to make it a little faster for you guys. And I did get a little bits of paint in certain areas, but it wasn't enough that it bothered me. And then I kind of just sponged around all the edges because I thought that would look good. And after my feathers dried, I decided that I wanted to kind of put some sort of phrase or quote or something in the middle of this because I thought it would look nice. And as you guys know, I kind of tend to like to do that. The only thing you want to keep in mind when you're doing a script on canvas is that you just want to be a little bit more careful because with acrylic paint and the texture of the canvas, it's a little harder to get a smooth script look. So you kind of just have to go slow and be careful with your lettering. But other than that, it's really fun. Again, you could also use a stencil if you wanted to do this and get a more precise look. Or if maybe you're not artistic and you don't want to chance it, a stencil always works great. You could even use an airbrushing technique on this. There's lots of different ways you could do this. Or you could even just iron on some letters as well. So that's always an option as well. But for this part, I'm probably just going to add some music and then we will get on to the next part of this video, you guys. Now we're going to be sealing what we just finished creating with some matte medium, or you could also use some Mod Podge, same thing. It just helps seal and protect your cover, and I really recommend this if you're going to be using this and putting it in your book bag or in and out of your purse, just to make sure that nothing happens to your cover and it stays, you know, nice and clean and nothing ever chips off because this is paint, so that could happen. And now that it is dry, it is ready to go. And for our last and third option for your covers, and the easiest in my opinion, other than obviously just buying a cover from Michaels, is using some washi tape. It's really simple, and most of us have washi tape in our stash, so in general you really shouldn't be spending a lot of money doing this. Three rolls in general don't cost that much, and if you don't have them in your stash, it's a really good investment for a planner gal to just have some washi tape in her stash, in my opinion. And since I have plenty, because the struggle is real, I figured it would be a great way to show you guys how you can create a simple pattern using washi tape on your cover. And the great thing about it is you can change out this cover whenever you get sick of it, because as girls, you know, we love to change things up and we get tired of looking at the same thing. So once you're tired of this, you could always take it off and put different washi on it. Or if you really like the cover and you don't want to change it out, you could also seal it with some matte medium or washi, or Mod Podge to seal it if you want to stay and make sure that it doesn't come off at any point. So that's just a great option for you to have. And basically, I'm just going to be cutting off the edges of any excess that hangs off. And you could also use a razor blade, or by razor blade, I mean X-Acto knife. But if you're underage, then I would ask your parents to help you with it. But if not, you could just use a scissor and simply cut the edges of this, and you're basically good to go. I decided to just use my scissor because it's quicker, but X-Acto knife might be a little bit more precise, but I think it came out fine just using my scissors. So, and I was really happy with the way that the cover looks, and I think you guys will love it too, no matter what pattern you use. And you don't have to use my pattern. You can do cross hatch or whatever it is that you feel like it. The limit is only your imagination, really. So this is just a great option for you guys to see that you can do lots of things using washi tape. For the really exciting part, working on the inside of the planner. I'm going to be using this calendar book that I picked up at Michael's as a template because it goes inside the planner, so it's just kind of easy to use that as like my guide. And then I have this stack of these beautiful 12x12 washi papers that I've been hoarding but finally decided to use for this because I think they're just so gorgeous and they're kind of perfect for dividers inside a planner if you ask me. The only bad thing about them is that they're not double-sided, which creates a lot more work because papers that are double-sided have patterns on both sides, so it makes it a lot easier, and you don't have to double up the paper, which is what I'm going to have to do in order to make this work, because I don't want to just leave one side super gorgeous and then another side plain. Personally, I like to have patterns on both sides, but you could just do one side if it doesn't bother you. It's really up to personal preference, but my personal preference is to have two patterns. So I did double it up and it laminated just fine, in case you were wondering about that. And I just cut along the lines to get this ready to go, and it fits perfectly on there. Now I'm just going to mark where my holes are going to be. I tend to punch my holes before I laminate. There's no specific reason or rhyme to that. I'm pretty sure you could do it either way. I just like to do it ahead of time because I figured it's less thickness to have to worry about, so that's why I'm doing that just there. And I'm using my Cropodile tool, which a lot of people ask me about, and I will link it in the description box below. The new version has like these beautiful Tiffany blue handles that I really want, even though I don't need because I still have this one. But basically it has two different size hole punch, a standard and a smaller one, as well as an eyelet clamp. So it's really, really like one of the best tools ever. I've had it for years now, so it's just stuff I've had in my stash because I'm a crafter, basically. And now I'm just using some crafty power tape to make this all sticky and glue it to the other side of the paper. So now that I've doubled up, I'm just cutting off the edges to the other side of the paper to make sure that this looks as nice and neat as possible. And it came out really pretty, and I love, love, love that rainbow paper right there, as well as that hexagon one. It's just so pretty. So you can use whatever papers you guys have, or you can find something pretty. I will see if I can find this paper stack in my stash, but we will see. Because a lot of stuff I hoard, so I don't know if it's like still available or not. But I am once again cutting holes in the papers before I laminate, just because, I don't know, I always do that. Maybe it's an OCD thing, but I just feel like I'd rather have a guide ready to go before I laminate for whatever reason. So now that that's ready and all my papers are pretty much doubled up and ready to go, now I'm ready to get laminating. How pretty are those papers? My goodness, these are going to be like the most gorgeous dividers. Generally, I like to kind of design my own dividers using art and print stuff, but I just loved this paper, so I thought it was perfect. And I'm just getting ready to laminate, and I picked up that laminator from Amazon, and it was super duper cheap. So if I can find the seller or the link I got it from is, I will link it in the description box, because I do feel like it's a great investment. I tried to avoid buying a laminator for like the longest time, but finally I kind of just gave in because it's just so useful, and you can't really beat the price that you can get one for that's like refurbished or whatever. So I definitely recommend refurbished one if you don't mind it being refurbished, because it's so affordable. And now I'm just cutting off the edges of all of the lamination, and try to leave a small edge if you can, because you don't want to cut too close to the paper. You just want to leave that extra edge, and then I'm just punching out the rest of them, and they're ready to go basically. And I really love the way they came out. Just kind of decided which ones I wanted to wear. And you could make more than just three dividers. I just don't think personally I would need more than three dividers. So that's why I did it like that. And I'm still deciding whether I want to add like actual little tabs to each one of these or not. I'm not sure yet, but I'm sure you will see by the end of this video whether I do or not. And then now I'm just adding back in the book. I was considering covering this book cover with paper as well, but I decided against it because it's not really necessary. It's like an extra step that's not needed. And I didn't laminate this with that saying inside of it, because I figured that way I can change out this kind of dashboard whenever I want and add a different quote whenever I feel like it. So it kind of gives you a little bit more versatility. And I'm just using that little be washi with gold hearts on it that is to die for, to basically tape that down on there. And since it's repositionable, I can take it off whenever I want. And then I just decided to switch the top washi because I'm OCD and it didn't look balanced to me. Because of the way that it was cut. So I love the way that looks. And I did decide to create a pocket in front of this calendar book, because I just thought, how convenient would it be to have a pocket on this book so that whenever you have extra little goodies that are loose, you can do that. So I'm just marking off where the book's length and width is for that pocket with my little Hello Kitty pencil. And now I'm just cutting that down, and I'm just making sure that it fits correctly. And I decided to pull out my trimmer for this one because I just wanted to make sure those lines were extra straight, because of the fact that since this is vellum and it's see-through, if it's not perfectly straight, it's going to be really, really noticeable, and I don't want it to bother me later on. So generally that doesn't bother me too much, but I thought for this it would kind of bother me. So I just pulled out my handy-dandy Fiskars trimmer and decided to trim it down like that. And then I decided I wanted to do the pocket at an angle and stamp a pattern on it. So I pulled out the stamp set that I designed with that little flamingo, and I wanted to just stamp that with some VersaMark. But I ended up switching actually to ArchivaLink, which I will link in the description box below, because the VersaMark kept smudging. So I actually off camera had to cut another pocket and stamp it in Archival, just a quick note, because Archival dries a lot faster and permanent than regular ink. So that's just something to note. And I just wanted to make sure to mention that, because I didn't want you guys to have a complete mess up or anything like I did with my first one. So that's just a note. And then I'm just using my Tombow Mono Multi Adhesive to glue down this pocket. You need very little of this glue because it works really well. And because of the fine tip, it gives you the perfect amount of glue. You don't want to use too much and have it like smush out and then ruin your pocket. So that's something to keep in mind. And then I did add some of those white reinforcements because I just like the way that it looks on there. I didn't really need it. It was more for the look of it. I like the way that it looks. And that is ready to go. And how simple was that, you guys? I added this cool pocket and just added that design element to that and kind of made the notebook look a little bit more snazzy. So I hope you guys like that little tip. And Let's go on to the next part of our video, which is creating some really, really cool inserts for your planner.